Hey everyone, it's Kristen from k.becca.com, and today we're going to be talking all about how to use custom patterns to create pattern fills in Silhouette Studio. I touched on this topic in an earlier video in the print and cut series, but wanted to dedicate a whole video to it so we can go over the process more in depth. There are some differences between how you can upload and use patterns in the basic free version of Silhouette Studio versus Designer Edition and above. But most of the pattern fill options are available in both the free and premium versions of the software. I've got a blank file open here, and the first thing that we're going to do is to turn on registration marks, since pattern fills are print and cut elements, so we'll need to print them on our printer and register the elements that they're filled with using our die cutting machine in order to cut them. To activate registration marks, go over to the far right menu and click the top icon, the one that looks like a little piece of paper, to open the page setup panel. Next, click the far right tab in the panel and choose the registration mark style that matches your machine from the style dropdown. I chose type 1 since I'll be using a Silhouette Cameo. Now we want to start making shapes that we can fill with our patterns. So first I'll head over to the far left menu, mouse over the drawing tools icon, which is the little rectangle, and choose one of the shapes from the menu that pops out. I'll just choose the draw rectangle option, and then go over to the artboard and click and drag to create a rectangle. The first way to add pattern fills to your shapes is by dragging and dropping, and this is a really quick way to pull patterns into your file if you don't care about having them saved in your library. This method works in both the basic free version and premium versions of the software. I have a window open here locally on my desktop, and this has some autumn plaid patterns that I want to use in some of my shapes. I'll drag the window around to a place where it's not completely covering the shape, and then I'll click and drag one of the patterns out of the window and over the shape that I want to fill. You might see a loading window pop up briefly at this point as the pattern is loading into the file. Then the shape will fill with the pattern. Next, we'll type out some text to fill with a pattern using the drag and drop method. I'll choose a nice wide font for this so a good amount of the pattern will show inside the letters. Next, I'll type out some text and I'll click down on my taskbar to reopen the window with all of the plaid patterns and click and drag one of the patterns over the text to fill it with the pattern. What happened here was that I dragged the pattern over the text and you could see that it briefly filled with the pattern, but I didn't stop clicking on my mouse after the text was filled and accidentally dragged the pattern off of the shape. If this happens, the fill won't remain in the shape and you'll have to redo the drag and drop process, making sure to let go of the mouse once you see that the shape is filled. When you have separate text letters like this or separate shapes that you want to fill with the same pattern, what will happen is that the pattern will treat each individual letter or shape as separate from the others, and each will be filled with a separate instance of the pattern that is automatically scaled to the shape. Sometimes this may be what you're going for, but more often than not, you're going to want to treat a word like this, and sometimes separate shapes, as a single element, and you have a couple of options for doing this. The first option is to select all of the shapes that you want to combine and weld them together using the weld tool, which I unfortunately forgot to show here, and which is probably the easier way to do this. Or you can do what I'm doing and go up to the object menu and choose Make Compound Path from the dropdown. After you do this, the pattern fill will disappear, and if you're using the drag and drop pattern fill method, you'll need to drag and drop the pattern into the shape again. So it's better to make the compound path before you fill with a pattern. You can see when I drag the pattern into the text this time, a single instance of the pattern will fill the entire word, and the pattern scale will be larger and uniform across the letters, which looks much better. Now let's learn how to upload patterns to the Silhouette library and use them from there. First, I'll go up to the top right area on the screen and click the Library tab. Any patterns that you download from the Silhouette Design Store should be stored in the Patterns folder, and we can also upload our own patterns from the desktop here. I want to keep things fairly organized, so I'll select the Patterns folder and right-click on it. Then I'll choose New Folder from the drop-down menu that appears, and you'll see a subfolder appear under the main Patterns folder. You can rename this to whatever you'd like. I'm going to create two folders, one for autumn plaids and one for a coordinating set of autumn patterns. So I don't know if this was a software glitch or if this is just how it is, but I was able to create subfolders in both the basic and designer versions of the software but I was not able to upload any patterns to the subfolders in the basic free edition. So I could make the folders, but couldn't put anything in them. All of the patterns went straight to the main patterns folder in the basic edition of the software. In the premium editions of the software, and I'm using the designer edition, I can select a subfolder, choose the pattern or patterns that I want to add to the library from my local computer, and drag and drop the patterns into the subfolder. You'll see the loading bar appear to show that the patterns are uploading, and this might take a minute or so depending on how many patterns you're uploading and how large the file size is. Next, you'll see thumbnails of all of the patterns in the subfolder, and you might notice the word queued over top of the thumbnail, and a zero or whatever number out of however many patterns you're uploading under the word queued. I googled around and couldn't find any specific information about this, but Silhouette is all about saving everything to the cloud now, so I think that when you see queued over the pattern, it means that it has yet to be uploaded to the cloud. When it is, the word and numbers disappear from the thumbnail. You'll notice some icons under each pattern thumbnail. When you click on the star icon, the pattern will be marked as a favorite and shown at the top of the list of thumbnails in the folder when you open the pattern fill panel in the design window. If you don't want your pattern to be saved in the cloud, you can click on the green checkmark below the pattern and a window will pop up where you can choose to make it available only on your local machine, so it won't appear in your library on any other machine besides the one that you're currently using. If you choose to make a pattern or element local only, the green checkmark will change to a black X icon. In addition, when you mouse over individual patterns, an icon with four corner brackets will appear below the thumbnail. If you click on this, a large thumbnail will open, but I noticed that these were always blurry, so this option wasn't that helpful for me. After I've uploaded all of the patterns that I want in my library, I'll go up to the top right menu and click on the Design tab to go back to our print and cut file. You have a couple of options for adding pattern fills to shapes once they're in your library. First, you can go over to the far right menu and click the little paint palette icon to open the fill panel. Open the pattern fill panel by clicking on the far right tab, the one with the little polka dot pattern in it. When you scroll down in this pattern, you'll see a bunch of patterns that come free with Silhouette Studio, and underneath those patterns, you'll see all of the patterns that you have in your library. Since I made subfolders for my pattern sets, they're listed in separate subareas. If you have the basic version of the software, they'll all be listed under the main pattern folder unless you've organized them in subfolders in a premium version of the software and kept them saved in the cloud. In that case, you'll see the organized subfolders listed even in the free version. To use any of the patterns, you just have to make sure that the shape that you want to fill is selected. Then click on the pattern that you want to use, and the shape will be filled with that pattern. Another way to use pattern fills is to click back over to the Library tab while the shape that you want to fill with the pattern is still selected in the design area. Then, in the library area, you can click on any of the pattern fills that you want to use on the shape, and when you click back to the design area, you'll see that your shape has been filled with that pattern, and you can work with it from there. There are lots of options for you to further customize pattern fills, and all of these are available in all versions of the software, both free and premium. You can adjust the transparency to lighten the pattern, and under the Advanced Options area, you can mirror patterns and change the aspect ratio, and you can also change the angle of the pattern fill by either 90-degree increments via the little rectangle icons here, or you can set a custom angle using the angle slider. You can also scale the pattern using the scale slider, but be careful not to scale the pattern too large because it might end up being blurry or pixelated when you print it out later. I've noticed that patterns are often sized down by default when you fill shapes, so you'll typically be able to scale them up to at least 150 or 200% without a problem. The pan pattern option is one of my favorites because it allows you to move the pattern around within the shape so you can place the pattern exactly as you'd like to see it printed. So if there's an area on the pattern that you'd like to show and it isn't placed where you want it by default, you can pan the pattern around until it's just where you'd like it to be. After you click the Pan Pattern button, and I'll zoom in here so you can see it better, a little circle with a four-sided arrow inside will appear. Just click and drag this to move the pattern around inside the shape. I'll choose another pattern fill here that is illustration-based because I think this will be a better example of what you can do with the Pan Pattern tool. In this example, you can move the pattern around until certain leaves are in certain places and make sure that the edges around the pattern have a good image balance before printing. Next, I'll choose another pattern fill for the text, and I think this is a great example of how useful all of the pattern fill options are for scaling and precise pattern placement inside smaller, more detailed shapes. Before I make any additional pattern fill shapes, let's talk about the print bleed option that's available in newer versions of Silhouette Studio. Open the page setup panel from the far right menu, and at the bottom of the panel, you'll see a print bleed area with a checkbox to turn the print bleed on and off, and a bleed radius area where you can adjust the size of the bleed. Having a print bleed will provide your machine with some wiggle room so that if it's a little bit off when cutting, there won't be a white space where printed pattern or color should be. Bleeds are used all the time in graphic design, and it's a nice addition to the Silhouette Studio software. I'll click the checkbox to turn the print bleed on, and I'll slide the bleed radius up to the max of 0.197 inches. It's really not necessary to have the bleed set to the max since, at least from my experience, when the machine is off registration, it's usually only by a little bit. I just want to get the best view of what the bleed looks like when it's printed, which is why I set it to the max value. When you turn the print bleed on, you won't be able to see a preview in the software, which in my opinion is a big downside and something I hope the developers will change in future versions of the software because it's so helpful to be able to see where the bleed ends, especially on a page like this where I'm going to fill it up with pattern fill shapes that are pretty close together. As it is now, you just have to guess where the bleed will end and hope that there's no overlap. So just make sure to keep a decent amount of white space between shapes. After the page is filled with pattern shapes, it's time to print and cut. I'll click the Send tab from the top right menu, then adjust the cut settings for the cardstock that I'm using, and then I'll go up to the top left menu and click the printer icon to send the file to the printer. When you have this many pattern fills in a file, it could take a couple of minutes for the full file to be sent to your printer. I'll print this page out, and I'll see you over at the machine for registration and cutting. Okay, I have the printed page here, and you can see that the max bleed is pretty large. There is a little bit of overlap, but luckily the overlap is from bleed area to bleed area, and none of the bleeds overlapped enough to go into the main cut area. I thought that the bleed area would just be an extended area of pattern, but instead what happened is that the edge of the pattern is dragged out to the edge of the bleed, and besides the colors matching, the bleed area obviously is not an extension of the pattern. So if your machine is just a slight bit off, which in my experience is what usually happens if it's off at all, you won't notice. But if your machine is off by a lot, then it will be obvious where the pattern ends and the bleed begins. I was a little bit disappointed about this, but for solid color fills, you won't be able to notice the bleed at all because there's no variation in appearance like there is with a pattern. Now we'll place our page on a mat, load it into the machine, and I always close the cover of the machine during registration because I've found that this helps prevent registration failure. I'll go over to the computer and hit the send button to start the registration and cutting process. When the machine is finished cutting, I'll unload the mat and start removing the cut shapes from it. You can see when I remove one of the shapes how large the maximum bleed radius is, and you typically won't need it to be this large. I've been using a bleed of somewhere between the minimum 0.05 inches and 0.075 inches with a lot of success. I've had really good results. I'll finish removing the cut pieces from the mat, and they all turned out beautifully. Actually, I don't think I even needed a print bleed for this because the registration was spot on, but it's always nice to have the print bleed safety net, even if you don't need it. Print and cut is one of my absolute favorite features of the Silhouette cutting machines because it opens up a whole world of possibilities for creating custom elements and embellishments for card making, paper crafting, and even vinyl designs. You can find a full list of supplies used in this video in the description area below or in the area below the video if you're watching on k.becca.com. I hope that this video was helpful for you, and you will definitely be seeing many more print and cut project videos from me in the future because there's just so much that you can do with it. Thanks for watching, and I hope you'll tune in again soon.